My name is Raegan Higgins. I'm an associate professor of mathematics and statistics at Texas Tech University. I would say that I was okay at math, just average. To me, math was just something that you took as a course, and no big deal. In eighth grade is when I became good at math, and that was a result of having an excellent instructor. Her name is Mrs. Gwendolyn Scott. I took Algebra 1 without taking pre-algebra, and I struggled. And she knew that I struggled, but she also recognized that I had the ability to succeed in the class. So as a result of her encouragement, her extra motivation, one of the things she did was move my seats. Another was give me extra work. And I think the one that was most profound was that she required all my assignments to be signed by my parents. So I couldn't hide my Fs anymore, right? I had to take them home and own up to my grades. So after having that positive experience with her and eventually excelling, I think I was learning of, you know, becoming a mathematician, whatever that meant to an eighth grader. In terms of being a mathematician, I think of that sometimes as two ways or one hybrid way. So if you mean mathematician in terms of an educator, I knew I was going to be an educator as a result of having a positive experience in Ms. Scott's class. I wanted to be her. I was like, I'm going to transform students' lives like hers. Because I felt so empowered after taking her class and doing well. It's like, I can do math, or I can do well really at anything. So after eighth grade, I'm going to be some kind of teacher. And I'm going to be Miss Scott. I'm going to be a math teacher. That's what the plan was. And then when I went to college at Xavier University in New Orleans, my advisor, Dr. Kosick, encouraged me to look at things in addition to or outside of middle school and high school teaching. He was like, you know about grad school? And I knew about grad school. My dad has, who's a retired teacher, has a master's in industrial arts, I believe. He's an architect / teacher. So he went to graduate school while I was in school. So I knew what it meant to get a master's degree, what it meant to take hard classes, to write things. I understood that. But what was new was the doctorate. Nobody in my family had a doctorate, right? So probably about my junior year, I was like, okay, I want to be a college professor, and this is what I'm going to do. So it wasn't, I guess it happened in stages, right? I had to figure out how to be an educator and then be a researcher and then bring those two things together. So I studied dynamic equations on time scales. Everybody, most people study, we work on the real line. Just that's the way the world works. We work on R. And you have differential equations that happen on the real numbers. Then there's this branch called difference equations, where you have equations that happen on the integers. So what time scales does is unify differential equations and difference equations. So it brings the continuous and the discrete together. So there's no need to have a differential equation and a difference equation. You can just have what's called a dynamic equation. Time scales is the overall thing that I study, dynamic equations on time scales. In particular, what I'm doing now is becoming more of a modeler, if that makes sense. My training is more theoretical. Now I'm becoming more applied. And what I'm studying is intermittent cancer therapy. So I want to be able to model prostate cancer treatments using time scales. And the reason you want to do that is because when you have any kind of cancer treatment, there's pauses, right? So you're on treatment for a while, and then you take a break and you do that again. Well, time scales is suited for that because you can have these breaks. You can have this work, take a break from treatment, and then pick back up. Whereas on the real numbers, everything is always going. Or on in the integers, you just have chop, 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 chop. So that's what I'm working on now, applying time scales to cancer treatment models. One struggle while I was in graduate school was passing qualifying exams, right? You have to take these exams to do all, you know, to move on. I realized that I needed more time. It wasn't necessarily that I didn't know the material. I just needed more time to show that I did. And in hindsight, it makes sense because our research is that way, right? You can't just go solve a problem in 4 hours. It doesn't work that way. So I learned after failing at least twice that I needed more time. And then once I had more time, I passed the exam. So that was a struggle because I was trying to do things the way other people did them, right? And I didn't know, it took me some failures to know how to ask for what I needed. So that was one. When I started my career on tenure track, I think a struggle was really how to develop a research agenda. Because, you know, you leave grad school and you say, okay, I have these problems that I can extend from my dissertation. But then what happens after that? Because you have this ready-made help, right? Your advisors, your dissertation team, they're there, right? You can talk to them. But then what happens when there's no one there? And especially for me, I went to a place where there were no people that studied timescales, right? So figuring out how to develop your research agenda and then collaborate, those were two challenges that I had. And it was just hard. Now, I think I know I'm better at it because I've collaborated more, but I also learned how to think about, I guess, tenure track differently, if that makes sense. Being promoted to associate professor is one road stop, a rest break, like on the way. I didn't have that mindset in the beginning. It was like, I made it. And you're like, yeah, you made it to number one, but you haven't made it to number two. So that challenge is really thinking about how to set your research agenda for 12 years. Who knows how to do that, right? You don't leave grad school with that mindset. I think now I'm figuring that out, but I'm on my track, right, to be promoted to full. Like, I'm working toward that, but it took me to get to this point to say, hey, I should have done that differently. So I can't give just one accomplishment. I mean, of course, there's getting the PhD. Being promoted is an accomplishment. A third is really just seeing the success of my students. When they do well in Cal 1, then they go do well in Cal 2, or they, you know, do well in differential equations. Like, you know, you've set the foundation of, they're taking baby reels and then they do well in papa reels, and they do, you know, the success of your students is definitely an accomplishment, because honestly, that's why I got into this, right? To change people's lives. So that every day, an email, a letter, or just when students stop by to say, hey, I'm doing well in such and such's class, or even when they ask you to write them a letter of recommendation, they remember some experiences that they've had in your class, and they're asking me to talk about that experience. And evidently they took something from the class too. So that's, I think student success is like a huge accomplishment. The work that I'm doing in the community, Mathematically Gifted in Black, to me, that's just, it's huge, because it was an unexpected thing. It was something that we just decided to do as four mathematicians, our passion project, and it's become a thing, right? People know about it, and it wasn't our intention. It was just like, we're going to create some awareness, create exposure, and we'll see where it goes. My affiliation with the EDGE program, I did EDGE in 2002, and I became co-director in 2017-18. EDGE poured so much into me in graduate school and the early part of my career, and still now, that I was just humbled to be asked to serve. So that's a huge accomplishment, to continue to make meaningful change in the larger community. Personal accomplishments, being able to figure out what work-life balance really means, right? Because balance is not, maybe you should say Jenga, Tetris, something. Like, there's no balance here. It's just the idea of how to move things around, right? And I'm getting better at how to navigate that and knowing when to just turn off and be okay with turning off. I feel like that's one of my greatest personal accomplishments, in that I'm doing this math thing the way it works for me and my family. As long as I am moving forward, then success is success. So in terms of role models or supporting people, I definitely have to say Mrs. Scott was a role model, a supporter, because she set me on the path. Dr. Kosick, my college advisor, he set me on the path. Even Nicole Johnson was my calculus teacher in high school. African-American woman, came in, commanded the room in a good way. And the way she taught us calculus was really to like think about it. It was not calculator based, and to really stretch your mind, you know, and put all these things together. So I think about her in the aspect that she understood math. And in my mind, that was high level math at the time, right? And she could explain high level math in a way that we could understand it. There are tons of people. I would definitely say my edge community has definitely been a supporter the entire time from 2002 until 2020. I've remained connected. If I need anything, I'm sure there's somebody, not I'm sure, I know, there's somebody in the math, in my edge community that I can call upon. So that whole community has been one big support system. People, I would say Amy Radinskaya, Amy taught me an edge, and I've talked to Amy about everything, just how to keep my research going, how to get through classes, how to make these balances, what things I should apply for, professional development, those things. My colleagues that I do MGB with, we all mentor each other on some level of thing, right? So everybody has a community, a team of people. I can't necessarily nail down one person to say this one person has been my mentor. I can say there are 25 people that I can put in my mentor bag and I can pull out and call them at one particular moment for certain thing, multiple things. So it just depends. There's not this one person fit all thing. I don't believe in that. So four things I want to share. The first is celebrate every success, whether you think it's big or small, celebrate your successes. The second one is never tell yourself no. Let somebody else do that, right? Believe that you can. Don't ever talk yourself out of working towards your goals. Third one is, and I'm learning this daily, when you fail, fail forward, right? So that you're not where you were, although you didn't accomplish what you set out to accomplish, you're still further along than you were at the beginning. So when you fail, and we will, fail forward. And lastly, I would say progress, not perfection, right? The goal is to get to the goal. And you don't have to get there in this perfect manner. The goal is to achieve it. So progress, not perfection.